Be anxious for nothing simply means that we're not to fret, we're not to worry. And that's a problem that we have as Christians that we ought not to have. Period. God repeats it over and over and over and over again. All the way back into the Old Testament, all the way up through the New Testament, the thing that people, that sets us apart from every other person in the world is that, among anything else, is the fact that we fret not. We are people that they can rely on. Now, we're going to look at a lot of examples of that, even in the Scriptures. People who fretted or we thought were fretting. This will be a study that takes a little while for us to go through because it's a problem that is so ingrained inside of us. And it's something that's going to take some time for us to learn to live differently because we are born into a system that literally mistrains us. And we as Christians refuse, get that, that's a fact, to step outside this system. God reminds us of it over and over and over. So over the next few weeks, we'll be learning things like how to stop worrying, allowing the things that are around us, and most of the time there are things that never even come to pass, but they choke the life right out of us. That word worry means exactly that, to strangle or to choke. We're also going to learn about how to cast your cares on God. We're going to learn how to be content, how to do everything and never complain. In everything that we do in life, to never have a complaint. Huh? What about that? I'm looking forward to y'all learning that one for sure. I'm telling you right now, huh? Stop your stinking whining, John. I'm over it. Suck it up and move on, boy. That's all I want to say, all right? So there you go. Doing everything and never complaining, living life by faith and trust, always having peace. Now, I'm not telling you it's going to happen fast. I'm going to tell you it can happen or God wouldn't tell us that it could. And then also, how do you deal with John Whites in your life? Oh, sorry. Problem people is actually what that says right there. Okay, how to deal with problem people. So, we will be studying those things. We'll be in Matthew chapter 6 again in just a minute because this is a basis. Now, just remember this. We are going to pray in just a minute, but just remember this. Jesus laid out for he had just called these disciples. He called these 12 men to come and to walk with him. He tells them as he calls them, he says to the fishermen who have a fishing business, this is their livelihood. This is their business. This is what they know. This is what they do. And he tells Peter and his brother and Peter's two cousins, he said, listen, I'm going to teach you how to fish for men and you will not fish for fish again. In other words, he was saying to these men, you're going to have to turn around and walk away from your business. Now, I can guarantee you Mrs. Peter wasn't happy when she got that news. She had just started. He had worked and worked to build up this business. She's finally getting new sandals and whatever else that she's always wanted. And Peter walks in and says, listen, get over it because I'm going to follow Jesus and it's going to cost us everything. And so Jesus sets them down and says, your life is going to radically change. You're going to get rid of everything that keeps you from being like the world, and you're going to begin to live an entirely different life. And so he tells them in advance. This is what Matthew chapter 6 is. They call this the Sermon on the Mount. And he sits them down and he begins to talk to them about the change that they're going to see in their life and how normally we would worry about those things. And he begins to tell them, you should not be worried because. And thus over the next few weeks, we're going to learn because why. Why shouldn't we be worried? And we're going to look at people in throughout history that God used these people in great ways, and some who went from being worriers to being warriors. And that's what we need to begin to do. And so, I hope you don't miss any, because these are going to be lessons that I'm learning greatly from. I'm telling you the truth. I'm going through it right now. Let's pray. God, as we look at your scriptures and we look at this Sermon on the Mount, We look at the things that you have to teach us. I thank you for this Bible study. I thank you for the fact that we're going to be flipping through the pages. And we're going to look at what Scripture says all through Scripture in a lot of different places about a lot of different people. And how, God, you radically changed their lives. And God, you changed their lives because they began to see who you were. And when we see who you are, we recognize who we are. And we realize you're way, way higher than us. Your ways aren't our ways, but you want them to be. You want us to begin to adopt your ways. You want us to begin to live like you and look like you. And so, God, you spend our days here being trans. You're transforming our lives to where we reflect you. You are conforming us to the image of your Son. And God, I thank you for that. I know that I have a long way to go, and there's a lot of work yet to be done in my life, but I want to be thankful that you think so much of us that you're willing to spend that time to change us and to transform us. I pray that this morning, God, as we study the Scriptures together, you will minister to our hearts in a very, very special way. Every person here has a different need. Some are alike, some are a little bit different, and some are a lot different. But God, you know every person, and you know their heart, and you know what they need to hear. And so, God, I'm asking you that you would do that just now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 6, what we read last week, Matthew 6 verse 19 is where we started, and we'll start there today. It says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth." Now, let me stop for just a second. Jesus begins with this, but then he begins, and we'll get to some of those today. I don't know that we'll get to all of them. He begins with the world system and how we get caught up in that to begin with. And then he moves to things like, don't worry about your life. And that's what we do. We tend to worry about how long we'll live or what's going to happen or our health or what can go wrong. God says, don't worry about that. Now, that's a big one. And then he says, don't worry about what you're going to eat. Some of you are worried about that right now. You know, right? Will he get done in time for us to eat supper or lunch? Or we worry about what we'll eat. We worry about what we'll drink. We worry about what we'll wear, what we'll put on. And Jesus touches on every one of those things because these men, that was going to be a concern to them, and because that's going to be a concern to you. And so the first thing he starts with is, you're going to have to begin to live a life that no longer looks at the world system. This was ingrained in these people all the way back to the beginning of time. The fall at Babylon, what took place there, all of that was around creating their own system. If you'll read, and tonight we'll be talking about this, probably it's going to come up. When Jesus Christ judges mankind, which is coming and is coming soon according to the signs that we see and the things that are taking place around us, when God does that, he is going to judge the world system that we're talking about right now. He's going to burn up all of those things that people have relied on and depended on all of their lives. He's going to level Babylon. He's going to level the financial markets. He's going to level all of these things that have been so important to us throughout history. And so he starts by saying, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust does corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Rather than to lay up treasures for yourself on earth, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven." We're all going to lay up treasures somewhere. That's what he's saying. So don't do it on earth. Don't store up all the stuff on earth. Begin to store up in heaven itself, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. And that's because where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. When you are focused on the things of the earth, that's what you're going to be focused on, no matter what it is. If you're focused on everything that God is trying to teach you to be focused on, your heart is going to be with Him. That's going to be the thing that drives you. People, things that you can bring to Christ, things that you can offer up to Christ, those are the things that are going to matter. He goes on to say, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye is single or focused and clear, your whole body will be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great and terrible is that darkness. And we discussed that last week. Then verse 24, and this is where we'll pick it up again today. There is no equivocation here whatsoever. Get that. No man, no human, no man, no woman, no person, no child can serve two masters. Period. No man can serve two masters. When you attempt to serve two masters, this is what's going to happen. You will hate the one and love the other, or else you will hold or cling or cleave to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. The word mammon, the most normal word that we have for mammon that we know about, is money. Money is the world system. We need money. Don't we need money? Huh? You know what? If I don't have money, my mortgage company says, it's all right for you not to have money, but you also ain't got no house. You know, I mean, that's, and you can go live somewhere. So we have a responsibility to go out and to earn and take care of our needs, certainly. But if our focus is not just our needs, but way beyond our needs, and besides that, we have learned pretty well how to have good and big needs. Much bigger than we ought to have, and much bigger than God has called us to have, are those kind of needs. And that's what leads us to get deeper and deeper into this world system. And so whenever He says to us, though, that we are not to serve two masters, that we are to be very careful that if serving two masters has become a part of our life, we must divorce ourselves from one so that we can focus on the other. And as we go through this study, I had two or three people this last week say, when you began to read what it means to be anxious and what the signs are of anxiety, I thought I was a pretty good deal. Until I began to read about all those signs of anxiety and realized 85% of those things are mine. Those things are eating me up. And that's exactly right. It goes from just a little bit of anxiety to a whole lot of anxiety till the point that we just don't even notice it because we're serving two masters. We're trying to. But when you begin to do that, you're literally neglecting God and living for the other and not even knowingly. Mammon is stuff. It is money, but it is also things that we gain from the money or things that money causes us to become enslaved to. I want you to turn in your Bibles, first of all, to 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Let's start at verse 5. Now, before we start at verse 5, understand who this letter is being written to. It's being written to Timothy. Paul writes this letter to Timothy. But always understand this. Every word of God is written by God Himself. He may have whispered in the ear to Timothy and breathed on Timothy or onto Paul and said, here's a letter I want you to write to Paul, but it's going to be good for Ron Sodrell. And so this is God inspired, God breathed. And so God wrote this letter to you and I. He is also, in that day, there were people that were false prophets. They were false teachers. These were people who would stand up, like I'm doing here today. Not a false prophet, hopefully, all right? But I'm standing up here today, and I'm going to share with you what the Bible says. But there are people today, in our world today, that you know, that you've seen, you've watched them on TV, or you've heard about them, or read their books, who stand up and proclaim this gospel to you. Now, he's not just talking about those people. He's talking about anybody who buys into that program. And so he starts out by saying this in verse 5. Perverse disputings. I'm going to back up to verse 4, which I didn't give that to Morgan. So he's talking about these people who lead people astray. He's proud. He's a fool, is what that word literally means. He knows nothing but doting about questions. He's acting like a fool about questions and strives of words. Wherewith comes envy? The things that he is sharing with you bring envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, or evil thoughts. These are perverse disputings or misleading arguments, perverse and misleading arguments of men that have corrupt minds. They are destitute. They are without the truth. These men do not even closely understand the truth. They suppose that gain is godliness. From such, withdraw thyself. If you turn in and you watch someone who stands and tells you, listen, if you'll send me $100, God's going to bless you beyond your wildest dreams. Keep your money. And if I start doing that in this church, fire me. Get rid of me as fast as you can. You won't hear us talk about that. I don't know what anybody gives. I don't talk to Lisa to find out what anybody gives. I don't talk about to the people who count the money. I have no idea. I get a little note that big. I'm not kidding you. It's that big. And it says on that note, it's on my desk when we get done, that says 2590 and 136 people last week. That's all I know. Somebody does every bit of that counting. They could be absolutely lying to me. It's my brother-in-law. It probably is absolutely lying to me, but that's all I know. And I'm not concerned about that. God takes care of us, and there's no question. And for people to stand up and begin to tell you, listen, Cheryl, I've told you this, some of you this before. Cheryl and I were traveling one time, and we were down in Macon, Georgia. And there was a television show. We turned this television show on that morning, and there was this man standing there, and he was an African American, and he had nothing but a complete gold grill. I mean, he was golded up. He had gold bracelets, and he had a Mr. T starter kit, you know, around his neck, and he was looking smooth could be. And so we are watching this man. His name was, and I thought this had to be a joke, because one of the kids' cartoons used to have this guy's name. He was Roosevelt Franklin was this man's name. Brother Roosevelt Franklin. And Brother Roosevelt Franklin was telling the people there in Macon, Georgia, send me your money. And he would take out his handkerchief. He said, send me your handkerchief. I'll pray over your handkerchief and I'll send it back to you. And so all of this is going on. All you got to do. And so then he would march up people with testimonials. And there wasn't a message preached at all that day that we ever heard, but he would march up these people with testimonials. And there were these ladies, kinda, of the night, it looked like, you know, who would march up there. And they would stand there and they were bedazzled. I mean, they were covered with jewels and all kinds of things. And she would say, I was broke. And I began to send my money to Pastor Roosevelt Franklin, and look at me now. I've got all kinds of wealth and money. And their motto, which was repeated over and over and over, was out of the ghetto and into the getmo. And that was exactly out of the ghetto and into the getmo. Now, let me tell you about that man. He was a charlatan. But there are men standing and preaching in churches that have 16,000 people, 20,000 people, and their motivation is absolutely no different. Their whole desire is that you gain because they gain. And that's exactly. And exactly, to be honest, it's their gain over your gain. But if you gain, maybe you'll step up. You know what we talk about? I have people who will say to me, they'll say, you know that guy over there? God has really blessed him. And I'll say, well, let me ask you a question. How do you know God's blessed him? And they'll say, well, have you ever seen his business? Let me tell you something. The devil can bless a business just like God can. When God steps out of the way, God can step back and allow the devil into a situation, and that can flourish in exactly the same way. And we see it all around us. That's exactly what this scripture says. Perverse disputings or arguments, misleading arguments of men of corrupt minds, and without the truth, destitute of the truth, supposing, believing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw yourself. What is godly is godliness, but godliness with contentment is great gain. When you have this peace in your life, no matter what you have in your pocket, if you have that, that is great gain. It says here, we brought nothing into this world. I can testify to that. I have 3 children and 9 grandchildren. I was there when those kids were born. There wasn't one of them that showed up with a pocket full of money. To be honest with you, they was all born naked, and they didn't have nothing on, and they had no money, and they didn't have anything. And for the most part, we've all lived that same way till today, right? There's no one that comes into this world with anything, and trust me, there is no one, according to the Word of God, that carries anything out. Not one person carries anything out. I've said this before. If you go down to the, and I do funerals, if you go down to the funeral home and buy a suit from the funeral home, there are no pockets in it. Did you know that? If you buy a funeral home made suit, they don't come with pockets because you ain't taking nothing with you. You know the old saying, you ever seen a hearse with a trailer hitch? No, sir, you sure don't, because you're not going to take nothing with you when you leave here. You know why we know that? Because God said so. Godly contentment is what we are to live for. A peace that passes all understanding. He says, we brought nothing into this world. It is absolutely certain that we will carry nothing out. A child, a baby, you watch them when they're born. You go back here and now and look at a baby. Their fists are like this. You ever notice that? You ever notice that a baby's fist is like this? They work their hands and their fists are like that all the time. They're born with their hands drawn up, stretched, moving like that. You know what happens when you die? Your hands go just like that. You grasp and you grasp and you grasp all of your life, but the minute you're gone, you're not going to take anything with you because you can't hold it. You let go. You're free. It's done. It's over. It goes on to say this, having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. Remember when we were talking about godliness with contentment is great gain? What is that contentment? Having food and raiment, clothing. It's not talking about a closet full of clothes. It's not talking about freezers full of food. It's talking about dinner. It's talking about what you wore into this building. That should be enough for you to be content. It doesn't take gaining all of those other things to bring you contentment. Let me pause and say this. It's okay to have some things. It's okay to have a freezer full of food. It's okay to have much of that. But it's certainly not necessary. You know what? I was thinking about this the other day. The freezer full of food. I remember getting up one morning. We had 2 dogs and a cat that lived in our garage. And they all got along good. If you went out there in the middle of the night, the 2 dogs would be sleeping and the cat would be right in the middle of it. The cat was the best cat I've ever seen. It had no idea it was a cat. It thought it was a dog because it always lived with the dogs. And so when you went out, that old dog, that old cat would be right there with them dogs. Well, I went out there one morning and I started through the garage to let the dogs out. And as I was going back through the garage, I walked by the freezer, or that area over in that corner over there, and there was blood everywhere. And I looked around and I didn't see the cat. And I thought, holy smoke, they had a feud last night and the dogs ate the cat. And you know, I couldn't find the cat absolutely anywhere. I thought, man, how am I going to tell Cheryl that her cat just got eaten by the dogs? And so, good work, boys. Anyway, I'm looking around and I opened up the door. And as I opened up the door, I looked back at the freezer. And out of the bottom of the freezer, blood's dripping out of the bottom of my freezer. And I went over and I popped open the lid of the freezer, and all that food was ruined. A freezer full of food was ruined. Now, I didn't really think it was, but Cheryl said, I'm never eating that stuff. You know, I said, I think we can deal with this problem. All of that food was gone, ruined, shot. Now, if our reaction to losing that freezer was to go berserk and yell at each other and scream at each other about who did this, what caused this problem, why'd that have to happen? And it was caused by human error, as a matter of fact. But if that would have been something that would have triggered in us anger, upsettedness, and all of these reactions, we've got a problem. Right? Because we have just put our joy and our contentment in a freezer full of food instead of the living God who knew and knows all things. We must get to the point of understanding who God is. God doesn't miss anything. God puts these things, God, listen carefully, puts these trials and tests in our life to show us where we are spiritually. And when we fly off of the handle, when we respond wrongly, we are learning what our true character is. And we begin to see where we are with God. And so God sometimes will pull the plug on things in our life that create angst and bitterness and anger at other people. He goes on to say this in the scriptures. They that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Hold it. Back up just for a second. They that will be rich, those who are focused on their wealth, and those who may achieve that wealth, will fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men. Wait a minute. I thought getting all that stuff was awesome. But it actually takes people and destroys them. I have a friend. One. No, I have friends. But I have a friend in particular that when I read that scripture, he always comes to my mind. He literally was one of my best friends. And we went to church together. We spent time together. In the same building, going to classes, doing things as we grew up. These words ring in my ears. He began to focus on his business. And it was real important to him that his business do very well. And we would have discussions about that. I would tell him, business is great. I hope your business is just huge, amazing, but don't leave God out of your life. Because if you begin to focus on that other God, Mammon, it will destroy you. That's what that's talking about. And so I remember when they came to him and asked him one time if he would be willing to be a deacon in the church we're in. And he came and said, listen, I'm going to talk about this and I'm going to pray about this, but I'm going to turn this down. I said, well, you haven't even prayed about it yet. How do you know you should turn it down? And he said, because I don't have time to be a deacon. I'm building this business. And that has to be my focus. I said, well, I'm not telling you to be a deacon, but I'm going to tell you this. Be sure that you're doing what God wants you to do in this situation. You're only talking about a few hours every month serving as a deacon. Surely you can give up a little bit of time if that's your cause and that's what you're worried about. And he turned that down. And I'm going to tell you this, that guy hasn't darkened a church in years. I'm saying 35 years. But he's very wealthy. And in the eyes of the world, he's quite successful. But see, success is not in your eyes or my eyes, it's in God's eyes. That's what makes a man a success. It's what God thinks about you. And that's exactly what that scripture teaches. Here's a man who's drowning in his riches. He's drowning in his riches. The love of money, not money, people. The love of money is the root of all evil. Some covet after money. They're greedy about it. And they have erred from the faith. They've turned away from God. And in so doing, they have pierce themselves. They are stabbing themselves like with swords with many sorrows. It's created all kinds of angst and difficulty and sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee, run, turn, get away as fast as you can, and follow after righteousness. Follow after godliness. Follow after faith, love, patience, gentleness, meekness. Fight. You and I as believers must fight the good fight of faith. You know what? That song that we did today, Onward Christian Soldiers, I read an article this week about the 10 songs that Christians need to take out of their service and get as far away from it as you possibly can. Now, this is written by a Christian person, supposedly, this article. The first one that they mentioned, Onward Christian Soldiers. And I'm thinking to myself, seriously? In 2 Timothy 2:2, it says this, you and I need to be warriors in the faith. We need to learn the Scriptures and teach the Scriptures and get in the battle as quickly as we possibly can and train up people to fight. You hear what I'm saying? To fight alongside us. And for that person, right here, it says the very same thing. We are to fight the good fight of faith. We're to be in the battle. This is not going to be easy. We're in a war for our very lives and the very lives of our children. I'm going to pause for 1 second. I'm going to say this to you. Listen carefully. Where do our kids learn the ways of the world? Charlie, you're exactly right, from their parents. We teach our kids to be anxious. We teach our kids to be bitter. We teach our kids to complain. We teach our kids to gossip. We teach our kids all of these things. And this anxiety is learned in the home by the actions of their parents. That's why we must be good soldiers. We must learn and be in this battle, in this fight. There is an enemy that's seeking to destroy you, Charlie, and them little children of yours. That's exactly what God says. Now, God's either a liar or we're misunderstanding things. He said there's a roaring lion looking for people to devour. We're going to look at one of those people that he went after. And we're going to find out how come he went after that man. God is involved in your life to teach you and to train you that we have an enemy and we must battle that enemy and we must teach others how to do the same, starting with your own family, with your own children, with your own grandchildren, those people that are closest to us. It says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. Grab hold of eternal life. Don't let go. Deliberately seek eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. In other words, don't get out, don't get in, and then jump out. And if you're thinking of jumping out, go on and get out. We'll get over you. Verse 17, charge them that are rich in this world. There are people that we love, that we walk with, that are rich in the things of this world, that they be not high-minded. Don't become proud over what you have. Do not trust in uncertain riches, but put your trust in the living God who gives us, if you have anything, God has allowed it. He has given us richly all things to enjoy. God's not putting stress in your life. God's not putting pain in your life. God gives us richly all things to enjoy, that they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate or give to the needy, not laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Now turn back to Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Therefore, verse 25, I say, therefore, I say unto you. When it says, therefore, I say unto you, take no thought. That word, take no thought, means this. Don't be anxious. Therefore, I say unto you, don't be anxious. Therefore, I say unto you, don't worry. Therefore, I say unto you, stop worrying. We start worrying. He says, take no thought. It means don't worry. Stop worrying. If you're worrying, stop worrying. But you don't understand. You don't know what's going on in my life. I don't have to know what's going on in your life. God says, if you're worrying, stop it. Isn't that what He said? Am I wrong? Danny, is that what He said? Isn't that what this is? Let me read that again real quick. Wait a minute. Therefore, I, Jesus spoke this. It's read in some of your Bibles. Therefore, I say unto you, stop worrying. Anybody been worrying? Anybody been worrying? Jerry, stop it. You're a deacon. What's wrong with you? You're making your wife worry. Did you see that? They're both worried. Stop your stinking worrying, Jerry. Stop it. That's a command from God Himself. Stop worrying. Identify the thing that's making you worry and stop doing it. Stop worrying. And then He says this for your life. The first thing we're stop worrying about is our life. Why should we stop worrying about our life? He's talking about the longevity of your life. He's talking about the length of your days. He's also talking about health and the things that cause us to worry sometimes. And it's natural that we do that. Isn't it natural that we do that? That we worry about when we're going to die? That we worry about our health and how long we're... Isn't that normal? Isn't that natural? It is absolutely natural. Because we were born people into a world that is natural, and we're supposed to begin to think and live differently. He says this. Don't worry about your life. Why shouldn't we worry about our life? Hold your place, but look at Job chapter 14, verse 5. Job 14, verse 5. Job's someone that we will take a look at as we do this study. You are? All right, am I good? All right. Y'all watched. I didn't do that. This thing's wacky. It is. It actually is. Yeah, this thing is wacky, right, Stace? We were talking about my health. That's why I turned it off. I didn't want anybody to know that. But exercise. That's good for us. It's great for us. If I have the most fit body in the world and I have exercised to the hilt, but God has determined that I'm going to die April the 27th, and I'm in excellent health, I'm going to walk outside and somebody's going to run over me at the end of my driveway when I'm walking out to get the mailbox. Do you understand that? Because your days are determined. Now, whether we like that or not, it's an absolute fact. Your days are determined. That's why we don't know what those days consist of, but God does. And so we begin right now living for God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, because if my days are determined to end this next coming week, I'm going to be in heaven. I'm ready. My days are determined. God is determined. He says this, your days are determined. The number of Ron Sodrell's months are with God. You have appointed His bounds that He cannot pass. I'm not going to live one second beyond when God wants me to live. God has predetermined that before I was ever born. God has been engaged and involved in my life just like He's involved in your life. God has planned for your life. I think that it's interesting Very, very interesting that God determines how long you live. Pay a close attention to this because it's an absolute fact. God determines how long you live. But remember this, you determine how well. You determine how well your length of days is on this earth. God determines how long those will be on your work on this earth. Look at Acts chapter 17. Acts 17. The Apostle Paul's coming through town. Not today. Apostle Paul's coming through the town. As he comes through town, he sees all these people worshiping false gods. And as he comes through town, he decides when he gets through the city of Athens, Greece, he's going to explain to them who God truly is. Verse 24, God that made the world and all things therein. Stop. God that made the world and all things therein. What would that include? Everything. God that made the world and all things therein includes everything but you, correct? No. God that made the worlds and everything therein, every one of us. God made us. God made us. That alone says that every baby in any womb is made by God. It is not determined by mankind at all. It isn't an inconvenience. I don't care how that baby got into somebody's womb. Listen carefully. I don't care about the condition of that baby in that womb. I am telling you this. God pre-planned every child that's in every womb. What we do with what God has planned determines what we are. Fact. God that made the world and everything that's in it, seeing He is God, Lord of heaven and earth, He does not dwell in temples that are made with hands. They had all these big temples in Athens where all their gods that were not gods were worshipped. He said, God is not worshipped with men's hands as though He needed anything. You know what that says? If this church goes bankrupt and dies, it's because God shut it down. You hear me? And any ministry there is, if there's a ministry that calls you and says, if you don't do something, we're going to close, you need to just let it close. Because if it's not God's ministry, then He doesn't. I'm not telling you not to give. I'm not telling you to pray about where your money goes. I'm just telling you this. If any ministry's relying on you, they've got a problem. They need to be relying on God to take care of their needs. And so when He says to us, neither is worship with men's hands as though God needs anything, seeing that He gives to all life, breath, and all things. God gives you life. He continues to give you life, and He takes care of all of your needs. He's made of one blood. Every human being on earth came from one blood. If a man is black, he has the same blood that I have. If a man is yellow, he has the same blood that I have. If a man is red, he has the same blood that I have. We are all from one man that God created. He made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth. And has determined the times before appointed and the bounds or where they will live of their habitation. You see, I am not today living in a Muslim country in the Middle East because God determined before He created anything that I would be born in Kentucky. Jack and Vivian went right across that river and had me in Kentucky. I was born in out of the whole clan of Sodrals, which there are many. I am the only one ever born in Kentucky, which makes me extra special, right, Charlie? Huh? Blessed, Emma. That's right. Huh? God determined that before time. That's what that says. He determined that I would be born in the year of 1950. I'm 68 years old almost, so don't sit and do the math. That's what it is. 68 years ago, He determined on May 25th, that's the day that I would be born. And He also has determined the day that I'm going to die. He's laid out my life completely. And listen very carefully, Jackie, He's done yours the same way. You understand that? And so if He's been that careful with my life, shouldn't I be that careful in giving it back to Him? Shouldn't I honor someone who has that much control in my life? Shouldn't I honor Him who has given everything for me? Shouldn't I give that tiny little bit of anything that I have back to Him? Really? What do I have that God would possibly want? When He owns everything, when He created all things, when all things belong to Him, all things came from Him, what could He possibly want from you? One thing, you. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body, which includes your mind, your hands, your feet, your arms, your heart, that you present your body a living sacrifice to Him, which is your reasonable service. It would be unreasonable for you to hang on to your life when God gave it to you to begin with. And be not conformed to this world. We were born conformed to this world. Don't stay conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We walk out of this room and we go, whew, I made it. One more week. I wonder how he'll yell at us next week. If I can just survive, if you can survive, you'll never live. Because your life comes when it's finally given to Christ. He gave it to you. Why would we withhold and not give it back to Him? Why did He do all that? That we should seek the Lord. If haply or perhaps they might feel after Him and find Him, though God's not far from any one of us. For in Him, in God, we live and we move and we have our being. As certain as also of all your own poets have said, we are God's offspring. Do you know that God wants you to have a full life? You see, we're afraid if we give our life to God, it's going to ruin everything. He's going to do to us like He did the rich young ruler. He's going to say, go sell everything you have, give the money to the poor, and come follow me. If we give our life to God, it will destroy any hope that we've ever had. And yet it was God Himself that said in John chapter 10, verse 10, I have come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. Life lived to the absolute fullest. That's what that means. I came that they could have a life that was overflowing, that it was full of joy, that it was full of peace. And if that includes prosperity, if that includes anything that we see the world have, that's just fine. But if it doesn't, it's still a full life and full of peace. Why wouldn't we want that? Why would we argue with God over the fact that all He wants for us is absolutely what's best? Your life? Don't worry about your life. Don't worry about the length of your days. Don't worry about your health. Pursue God. There's a verse in Scripture that is often quoted, but I think never thought about. We hear it often. All things, Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord. And then we go out and live like that's not true. All things, if I get a bad diagnosis, all things, if I lose everything that I own, all things, no matter what, it's for my good. It is for my good because I'm His son. I know that if God takes away everything that I have, like he did Job, God looked at Job after he had lost 10 children. 10 kids were killed. He loved them. He prayed for them every day. God said he's the most perfect man on earth. The most perfect human that's ever lived on earth at this time. Job lost all of his wealth. He was the richest man in the world. Literally, the scriptures say he was the richest man in the world. He was like, if you took everybody, Warren Buffett, and you took all of these guys out on in California that's got all the, and you piled it all up together, they didn't total up what Job had. He had more than anybody has ever had. He had more than anybody's ever had. God said he's the richest man that ever lived. And he will be the richest man that ever lived. He had it all. It labels all that he had, all of his wealth, all the things that were laid back for the future. It labels everything that he has. And God looked over at Satan, and he said, Satan, have you ever thought about messing with Job? Satan says, yes, sir. I think about it every day. It's consuming my life. I want to destroy him so bad. He trusts you, and I want to bring him down. And God turned to him and said, okay, don't touch him, but you can take everything he's got. He killed his kids. His wife turned against him. Destroyed his servants. Destroyed everything that he owned. Destroyed it. And you know what Job did? Job worshiped God. Job worshiped God. The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the Lord. Is that your heart? Are you hanging on? Something pretty important to you? You scared to give to God? Might as well quit worrying about it. You might as well let God have it, because he's got it anyway. He just wants you to grow up. He wants you to grow up and mature and become like him. Father, what kind of a loser would I be if I didn't give you back my life after you gave it to me? Seeing that you have already determined my days, what do I possibly think that I could in any way do to make it better than what you have planned for me? We have a completely world vision of who you are. We have been so tainted by the world system, and sadly, God, it has made its way throughout the church today. We have a world's view of the living God, and we must get back to you. We must turn our hearts back to you. Don't worry. Pray. Don't worry. Pray. When we worry, we have a problem. We need to pray. Because we need to invite you into that situation so that you can show us what's going wrong in our life. And what's going wrong is something spiritually that you want to help us through. Oh, Job, he may have been the best the world had, but he still had problems. And by the time he gets to the end of his lesson, he looks me in the face and he said, listen, God had it right and I had it wrong. God, I just pray that as a Christian, that I wouldn't be just a Christian. I want to be a man of God. I want you to be proud of me. Even though I've made a lot of mistakes and bad decisions in my life, God, I know that you've forgiven me. And you've forgotten all of those things based on the Word of God. I struggle with them, but God, you don't. And I know that you have a plan for my life, and you have a plan for every life in this room that does not include worry of any kind for any reason. God, I just pray we'll see that and understand it, and that our lives would be given wholly and completely over to you. because they belong to you anyway. In Jesus' name, amen.